Neither Xiaomi nor Huawei chose to partner with a Taiwan automotive OEM. Do you believe this is a well-sorted strategy?
A company like Xiaomi, like Huawei, which have significant brands that they want to pursue, that they already have significant ideas of what kind of digital experience they would like to have in the vehicle, the relationship with an OEM is not going to work with any OEM, quite frankly. And the reason for that is quite simple, is, you know, in some of the research that we've done over the last few years, we predict that the total demand for vehicles globally over the next 20 years might fall by as much as 65%. Now, if that happens, the OEMs that exist today are out of business. That means that what OEMs need to do is they need to find another source of revenues. Even if the market falls by just 30%, half of what we think is maybe possible, they need to find another source of revenue. And the best candidate for them is digital services in the vehicle. Now, that means they need to invest in their own digital experiences in the vehicle, and people who are driving OEM vehicles, as far as the OEM is concerned, need to be engaged with their experiences as much as possible. If you do a partnership with Xiaomi or Huawei, obviously there's a clash there. And that's why you'll see them go to companies that maybe don't have a brand, companies that are looking to be an EMS manufacturer for vehicles. And this is what Foxconn is currently doing, and which is why, you know, there was all that speculation around Apple doing a partnership with Foxconn to manufacture a vehicle. I would not be surprised if Foxconn has manufactured Apple's test vehicle that I referred to earlier. But for OEM companies, digital companies with a strong brand and a strong user experience and look and feel, it makes much more sense for them to go to an unbranded manufacturer to help them build a vehicle rather than an OEM, because you're going to have this big clash.
Currently, there's a tremendous amount of capital entering the EV market. Well, some EV brand hasn't sold a single vehicle yet. What do you think of the consequences when the bubble finally bursts?
The consequences will be dire, simply because the arithmetic or the numbers, they don't add up. Take Lucid Motors, for example. Lucid Motors trades at a valuation of excess of $20 billion, I think, last time. But the company has yet to sell a single vehicle and will need to raise more money before it actually generates any cash. Tesla is also similar. The arithmetic for Tesla does not add up. With where the company is today, the company is going to need to command 50, 60% of all of the vehicle market in the world in order to justify its current valuation. What's happening is there's a strong narrative. There's a story behind Tesla, i.e. Tesla takes over the world. And people, right now, what's currently going on with a lot of the EV sector is that the narrative is more important to investors than the arithmetic. Now, typically what happens is that at some point, don't ask me when, the bubble bursts and then arithmetic matters. And then you're going to see these companies have very great difficulty. I think the consequences are likely to be massive consolidation. So I think last time I checked, I heard that there were 400 electric vehicle manufacturers in your country, in China. Now, given that there are 26 car makers globally, one might think that that is a little bit unsustainable. So I think massive consolidation, a lot of people going out of business, is likely, and a lot of investors losing a lot of money, is likely to be the consequence of the bubble bursting. And because I'm an arithmetic kind of investor, I don't have any positions in the electrical vehicle space at all.